योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचां मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पतञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि आबाहुपुरुषाकारं शङ्खचक्रासिधारिणं सहस्रशिरसं श्वेतं प्रणमामि पतञ्जलिं गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। हरिः ओम्। सो वी हैव बीन लुकिंग एट चित्त परिक्रमा वन आफ्टर अनदर सक्सेसिवली एज डिफरेंट मीन्स टू प्यूरिफाई क्लेंस finish, polish, make ready the chitta in the yogic journey, right? And so last time we looked at, we completed one sutra, 1.36, which was Vishoka va Jyotishmati, where we looked at the Hrudaya and the Asmita. Then we looked at 1.37, Vitaraga Vishayam va Chittam. And in that context, we also spent some time trying to convey the appreciation of the teachings here, of Guruji's teachings, and how he blended the philosophical understanding with the teachings in the class and the things to pay attention during practice and so on. So today we look at 1.38. We start with a new sutra, and the sutra is as follows. It's again Patanjali providing another means for Chitta Parikarma. The sutra is Svapna Nidra Jnana Lambanam Va. Now in all of these sutras there is the word Va, which indicates that or this or that. So these are different means for Chitta Parikarma. So what is this particular means? It is Svapna Nidra Jnana Lambanam. So here, as you know, the key thing is alambanam. So alambanam is the support that the chitta will adopt. And as per the Sankhya Yoga conception of knowledge, the chitta takes the form of whatever knowledge it sort of assumes. Or whenever there is a jnana, it is as though the chitta is taking the form of that particular thing. So in this case, for chitta parikarma, where the object or the aim is to attain sthiti. If you remember, tatra prashanta vahita sthitihi, in very sort of simple translation, steadiness, right? Now for that sthiti, it says what, it suggests an alambanam. What is the alambanam? Svapna nidra jnana alambanam. So now, in the various darshanas, in general in Indian thought, there is a lot of time spent in understanding the three states, which is the Jagratavastha, the awakeful state, then the sleep, which may involve dreams, and Sushupti, which is dreamless sleep. And then there is a fourth called Turiya state, which is a transcendental state. So here it talks about Svapna Jnanam and Nidra Jnanam as the support for Chitta Parikarma. So we will talk in some amount of, we have touched upon the importance of sleep and the special, what makes sleep or Nidra special, when we talked about Nidra as a vritti. In fact, he also talked about it when we talked about the Vishokava Jyotishmati Sutra. So we will spend some time again a little bit, but not go into too much detail of that. But the key here is understanding what is this Svapna Jnanam and Nidra Jnanam. So let us first start by seeing what Vyasa has to say about it. And he has a very small bhashya, just a one-line commentary. So he says, Svapna jnana lambanam va, nidra jnana lambanam va, tadakaram yoginaha chittam sthitipadam labate iti. So this is very simple. So what he's saying is, the same thing I'm sort of repeating, Svapna jnana lambanam, which means taking the support of the knowledge of Swapnavastha, of the dream full sleep state, taking that as a support for the chitta, or Nidra Jnana Alambanam, taking the support of the knowledge of the dreamless sleep state or of Nidra, Tadakaram, of that form and shape, Yoginaha, of the yogi, Chittam Sthitipadam Labhate Iti, the chitta of the yogi attains the state of sthiti. So Vyasa sort of assumes that when we say Swapna Jnanam and Nidra Jnanam, we understand what that means. But here, let us go into a little bit detail of what that means. So let us look at some of the Vivaranam on the Yoga Sutra and the Bhashya, and what they say. What does the Vivaranakara say? So what is so special about the Swapna Jnanam and the Nidra Jnanam? So let us look at the Swapna Jnanam. So it says, Swapnecha Shabdadi Vishaya Shunyam Jnanam. So the knowledge in the Chitta, the state of the knowledge in the chitta, in the state of swapna. Swapna means the sleep which involves dreams or may involve dream. So it is not the stage of sushupti. In this case, it is shabdadi vishaya shunyam. So the imprint of the vishaya is not happening because the indriyas are not active in that state. Okay. Of course, you may say the sleep may get disturbed because of indriyas, but then it is no longer a sleep state. So when we here assume the Swapna state. So Swapna in sort of common parlance means dream. Okay. But in Sanskrit, when you say Swapi me, means I sleep. So it does not directly indicate dream necessarily. Okay. So Swapnam is a sort of the state of the sleep. Sushupti is a more particular state of sleep where there are no dreams. Right. But Swapnam is the regular state of sleep where there may be dreams. Right. So in that state, Shabdadi Vishaya Shunyam Jnanam. So there is Jnanam, but it is devoid of the objects of the Jnanendriyas, the objects of senses. So Shabda Sparsha Rupa Rasa Gandha, those objects do not exist. So it is Shabdadi Vishaya Shunyam. Then he says, I'll just finish.
You see, in Shabdadi Vishaya Shunyam, this is what he quoted. See, in dreams, you get objects. You can't have a dream without any object. Is that right? In dream you can see animals, flowers, plants, human beings, etc., etc., your friends and relatives, objects. So the dream will always contain an object. However, the object physically is not existing around. You can get dream of elephant on your bed and there is no elephant in your room, but you can see it. So objects are not there. So that's why Vishaya Shunya. However, dreams have objects with absence of objects. Dreams always have objects without objects around, physical objects around. That's why Vishaya Shunya.
Okay, so Swapne Shabdadi Vishaya Shunyam Jnanam. Shunya means zero, so devoid of that. So then there is further clarification. It says, Jnanasyapi Swabhavo Avabhasikata. Okay. So what is the nature of this Jnanam? It is Avabhasikata. So it illumines. Right? So Avabhasikata is Jnane Prakashe Mithya Jnane. Those are the meanings. So in this case, this Jnanam is in a, it is that Jnanam where the layer of the Indriyas has been removed. So the chitta is going more towards its essential state by discarding the layers that tie it to the external world. Right? And that is why there is some purification. So here what is happening, the indriya layer is being removed. And what is this, the nature of this jnanam? Even if you see an elephant, the jnanam is that of avabhasikata, jnanasya svabhavaha, the nature of the jnanam. Is it is illuminating something, right? So that is the nature of the jnanam that is to be made the support of the chitta, the nature of the jnanam in that state. So tatrapi jnanasvarupam eva avalambate. So the chitta is supposed to take the support of the nature of this jnanam. It is not supposed to take the nature, support of the nature of the elephant that you are seeing. So it is not the nature of the dream, not the nature of the swapnam. It is the nature of the swapna jnanam, which is of the pure nature of illuminating something, where the layer of the indriyas has been removed, so it is devoid of that. So slowly the chitta, which is a complex leading from the external world right until the purusha, the external layers are getting removed, and that is what is supposed to be understood in this sutra. And luckily we have a everyday experience of that. Therefore the yogi, given that he has a near experience of that, he is able to take support of that to cleanse the chitta, because now this particular alambanam is of the nature where one layer is removed, right? And gradually you can go towards the essential sattvic nature of the chitta. So again there is clarification. Tatrapi jnana swarupam eva alambate natu smaryamana vishaya swarupam. So what are the smaryamana vishayas? The things being recalled or recollected, such as the elephant. So the it is to be made clear that the dream is not to be made the support. Okay, natu smaryamana vishaya swarupam. Don't have consider the dream elephant as the support, but the nature of the chitta or the jnana in that particular state, which is avabhasikata, that is to be made the support. Smaryamane napi vishayena khalikaro drushyate. So if you include the dream itself or the dream objects, in that case the chitta is no longer getting pure. Khalikaro drushyate means it sort of the pollution remains. So you are supposed to remove the particulars of the dream, but catch hold of the nature of the chitta in the dream, which is pure illumination devoid of the indriyas, make that the support, and that is the swapna jnana lambanam. Now the next is the nidra jnana lambanam.
So it is swapna jnana lambanam. It is taking support of knowledge with regards to dream. It is not taking support of dreams. It is not swapna avalambanam, swapna jnana avalambanam. Now how do you get jnana about swapna? What are the means of knowledge? How will you get jnana? How do we get knowledge? We have been told earlier, it is either pratyaksha or anumana or agama. These are three means: direct perception, cognition, inferential cognition, or through scriptures, book of wisdom, book of knowledge, book of realities, postulations of realities, that is agama. Now, see, the point is that even although we are all experiencing a wakeful state, we do not have knowledge of a wakeful state. Although we all experience dreams so very often, we do not have knowledge about as to how the dreams occur, why the dreams are there. We all get dreams, but we do not know how the dreams can occur. What is the arrangement in our mind stuff consciousness for the dreams to come up and dreams to be experienced? So also we all experience sleep. We have no knowledge about sleep. Now Vyasa has just given one sentence of comment. It is because it is deemed and assumed that if you are in pursuit of yoga, you have some adhyatmic knowledge about as to what is a wakeful state, what is dreamy state, and what is dormant state. We do not have jnana about even our wakeful state. We know that we are awake, but we do not know what is this awakefulness. How does it really come about? Why does it stay for some time and then goes away? So we have no knowledge about these states of consciousness. We all have consciousness, but we do not know what consciousness is. And the states of consciousness. We do not have any idea. So it is on the jnana. A reference here is to jnana. And this knowledge will come by agama. Agama is the means, that is, scriptures are the means to be getting this knowledge. Can you ever think, let me see how the dream comes, I am going to keep awake and I am going to look for as to how the dreams occur. Or you can't say, I want to have knowledge of sleep, dormancy, I am going to keep awake and see how I get the blanket cover of sleep. This is not a matter of perception. You cannot ever perceive as to how the sleep comes and how you get dreams. Because if you say, I'm going to keep awake, that means you are discouraging the sleep to come up. How will it come? So this knowledge about Jagrata, Swapna, Sushupti cannot come by your empirical process. Let me know what is sleep. Let me know how do I get sleep. Let me know what is dream. Let me know how I get dreams. Let me know what is awakeful. What are you going to do? We are all awake. What can you do to know what is awakeful state? So there is no means by pratyaksha or anumana. That is why Patanjali and Darshana has taken recourse to means of knowledge, and it includes agama. It is only agama will tell us as to what is this state. Just give you very introductory information about what is awakeful state. It is beautifully described in our agamas, particularly Pancharatra agama. This awakeful state is called Aniruddha state. Aniruddha means unrestrainable. Now, you can't restrain yourself from your identity. Being awake, you can't be restraining your vritti, which tells you about your identity. I am man, I am woman, I am this, I am that, this is my name, this is my caste, class, street, gender. You can't forget when you are awakeful. The vritti which pertains to your identity is unrestrainable while you are awake. Do you follow? That you can't forget you are a man, you are a woman, you are middle-aged, you are old-aged, you are young-aged. You can't be forgetting. It cannot be restrained. So that's why the scriptures say it is Aniruddha phase of consciousness. Aniruddha means unrestrainable. You can't restrain yourself from your likes and dislikes being identified. Can you restrain yourself from the perception that you are able to see myself and him? You are able to see the platform. You can't restrain yourself from knowing these things when you are awake. You can't restrain yourself from your likes and dislikes, your loves and loathes. You can't restrain yourself from all those things. And that's why awakeful state is called Aniruddha state. And the dreamy state is called Pradyumna. It is to do some. The word has to do something with the light, illumination, as he said just now. See, even if you can see the things in dream, you can hear the things in dream. Perhaps you can get a dream that we are giving a talk on Yoga Sutras, maybe tonight. Possible that you will be hearing we speaking. Now this hearing is again luminous object in dream. Now this hearing of wakeful state is not luminous. We can have dark room, 100 total dark room, and we can talk and you can hear. We don't need light to hear. It is not illuminated verbal object. However, in dream, if you hear somebody's speech, it is illuminated verbal object. It is light form. It is not sound form. In dream, if you hear, it is not sound form. Like laser show. In laser show, you are shown so many effects by laser beam. So dream is a wonderful laser show within. It gives you visual objects, auditory objects, olfactory objects. You can get even fragrance of rose in dream. You don't just see the rose, you will get the even fragrance of rose. So touch sensation, tactile perception, olfactory perception, visual, auditory. Every kind of perception is possible in dream. And all these are light effects. All these are light effects. Shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. Even in dream you might see that thing that you are eating cake and you really relish the cake. It's not tasteless cake in dream. If you get a dream that you are eating cake, you don't get a tasteless cake. You get a tasty cake, delicious, deliciousness of it is tasted. That's why you say, I dreamt of eating cake in dreams. Now that's a gustatory object. But in dream, it will be light object. It will be illuminated in a form of illumination. Is it not a marvel to understand? Now this is divulged by agamas. As to how are the dream objects? You get shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha in dream. Objects of five forms you get in dreams, but they are all of one form, which is light, illumination. These are all light effects. All dreams are light effects. And that's why it is called pradyumna. Dyumna, dew, has got to do something with illumination. So the agamas explain about this. About sleep also, agamas will explain. He will be quoting certain things for you to know what is state of nidra, and we have seen during the vritti of nidra. Now, nidra in agama is called sankarshana. That's the phase of consciousness which is referred to as sankarshana, akarshana, karshana. Akarshana, gravity. That is gravity. So in a state of sleep, we are in such a gravity that all of us in dormancy are equated. A rich man, a poor man going to sleep, levelized. There is nothing called rich sleep and poor sleep. A rich man sleep and poor man sleep. Sleep is equator, it will equate. It will equate the rich and poor. Sleep will equate the young and old. The sleep will equate the young and old, strong and weak, man and woman. Powerful and powerless. It will equate everything. It is such a gravity that everything is equalized. Like you know about the black holes. They have enormous gravities. So if we are in vicinity of the black hole, we will be all drawn in. So I as a man will not remain in black hole as man. You as woman will not remain as woman in black hole. This object, inert object, will not remain as microphone. It will all be unified in the gravity of it. We will all become black hole. Is that right? If we enter black hole, we become part of black holes. It has enormous gravity. No identities are maintained. All identities are one identity. Now we have different identities. If we all get into black hole, we will lose all our identities. Why? Because it has such a gravity, tremendous gravity. So state of sleep is called sankarshana, which has to do something with akarshana, karshana, akarshana, samyak karshana, sankarshana. So state of sleep is wonderful equalizer. Man, woman, young, old, oriental, occidental, atheist, theist, emperor, beggar, diseased, healthy, everyone is levelized. It has such a gravity that all identities go away. Our sleep is a black hole. Every night we go into our black hole and we lose all our identities. We are just beings without name and form, without attribute, without characteristics. So the sleep has been described as Sankarshana, a phase of Almighty. There are four phases of Almighty: Vasudeva, Sankarshana, Pradyumna, Aniruddha. So this is what the Agamas tell us. So that's the Nidra Jnana. Nidra Jnana, we lose all delimitation: man, woman, young, old, caste, class, creed, gender, status, stature, caliber, everything goes away. In awakeful state, we all cling to our status. Is that right? In awakeful state, we all embrace to our delimitation, our gender, our age, our name, our race, our origin, our identities. So we are all embracing all these things, and in state of sleep, nothing is there. It is such a gravity, all those things fade up, fall apart. They all fall apart. That's why it is called Sankarshana. So those are three states of consciousness. The fourth state of consciousness is Turiya. If you are read in any of the texts of yoga, you have heard about it, transcendent state. That is Vasudeva. So Almighty's Vasudeva phase is Turiya. Sankarshana phase is dormancy. Pradyumna phase is dream. Aniruddha phase is Jagratavastha. So also Upanishads are described about Om, Om, three states. And the next half as Turiya. So Upanishads have divulged so many facets of these states: Jagrata, Swapna, Sushupti and Turiya. So it's a marvelous subject matter which is encompassed by Adhyatma. So Vyasa and Patanjali deem that we have some idea about this. That is by just one-liner commentary. Sapna Jnanam and its Alambana, Nidra Jnanam, its Alambanam. So it means, it assumes that we must have inquiry into what is really, what are these three states of consciousness. We all experience those states, we do have no knowledge about it. So don't think experience is knowledge and knowledge is experience. We have many knowledges, we don't have any experience. We have experiences, we don't have knowledge about it. So there are certain realms which you cannot experience in your empirical state. To be experiencing those, we require intuitively mystic states such as Samadhi. You will never experience, get to know about Swapna Jnan, Nidra Jnan, etc. as direct perception or experience unless you are in Samadhi. Even ingesting and assimilating all Upanishads, we will never get to know it. It is only in the intuitive mystic state that you will have revelation of what is Nidra Jnana, Swapna Jnana and Jagrati Jnana. So it's a marvelous subject matter. We only recourse we can take is to scriptures. Upanishads, Shastras, Agamas enormously tell us about what are these states. They tell us about Swapna Jnana, Nidra Jnana. And this Alambana will be another means for pacifying the chitta, cleansing the chitta, purifying the chitta, settling the chitta.
He mentioned the Upanishads, they correlate the varnas of the Omkara, Uma, with the different states. So let's just see for the Swapnavastha that I mentioned. The Bhashya, the commentary on the Mandukya Upanishad, which is the Upanishad which specifically deals with this waking state. Of course, the other Upanishads do too, but the correlation between the Omkara and the three states is almost the primary subject matter of the Mandukya Upanishad. So in the Bhashya, in the commentary, the Swapnavastha is nicely explained. So it says Indriya Pekshaya Antapragnya. So this pragna, which is the sort of awareness, right? It is Indriya Pekshaya Antaha. It is internal with respect to the Indriyas. So the normal sense organs and the Indriyas, which is the mental component of the sensing of the world, that is our normal prajna, the awareness. So this is internal with respect to that. Indriya Pekshaya Antapragnyaha. So here the reference is to that particular self. The normal self is the awakeful self. This particular self is internal with respect to the Indriyas. Vishaya Shunyayam Prajnayam. Okay, so now this particular awareness is devoid of Vishayas, as we saw, right? Sound and touch and so on. Kevala Prakasha Swarupayam Vishayitvena Bhavati Iti Taijasaha. So just like he talked about the different terms, Aniruddha and so on, in the Pancharatra Agama, in the Mandukya Upanishad, there are again different terms. There's a Vaishvanara for the wakeful state, Taijasa for the Swapnavastha, Prajnanagana for the Sushuptihi. So this particular Taijasa is being described. It says, it is internal with respect to the Indriyas. It is Vishaya Shunya, so the objects of the senses are absent. Kevala Prakasha Swarupayam, purely of the nature of Prakasha or light or illumination. Vishayitvena Bhavati, so this is Taijasaha. So this is the nature in the Swapnavastha. Then after a few things it says, Kevala Vasana Matra Prajna Bhojyeti Pravivikto Bhogaiti. So in this particular state, the bhoga, or in some sense the experience, is vasana matra. So it is the vasanas, the imprints on the chitta and the tendencies generated by them. They are the operative factors. The indriya layer has been removed. And that is the prajna in this particular case. And in that case, the prajna is termed as the taijasa. So now we understand sort of the mechanism of how things are operating in this particular state. And this jnana is of the nature of light or prakasha. Its support is to be taken when it says that swapna jnana lambanam, as one means of purifying. So now we have looked at the swapna, a little bit about nidra.
See, we tend to have a neglect about dreams. We belittle dreams. Is that right? Oh, after all, that was a dream. So we deprecate, look down upon dreams. However, nidra jnana cannot be belittled like that. You see, suppose there is a supercomputer here and a cattle passes by, a monkey passes by, eagle flies by. It just neglects a supercomputer which is around here, which is here. Is that right? But now, if you come across that this is a supercomputer, what will happen to you? Will you have neglect? Will you not be curious? What is this supercomputer? What are its abilities? What is its prowess? What will it do? What can it do? What can I do with it? Can I use it? How can I use it? The cattle, the cow and buffaloes and bulls, they just pass by. They will turn a blind eye towards supercomputer. We are doing that to our state of awakeful state, dormancy and dream. See, the dream is to be appreciated. If some of you have read my book, Yoga for Millennium, my talk on dream is there. So those that are not read, you can read it. See, dream is a marvelous state, enormous state. You can be engaged in a duel, a fight or bout with world champion wrestler, and you will topple the wrestler in dream. You will come victorious. You will come victorious in dreams. Now you know that you are ordinary average man and this is Mr. Universe or the world champion in wrestling. You can topple. You can be engaged in a bout with elephant, and perhaps you will topple the elephant also, and you will conquer elephant. Now you know what is your fate in front of elephant. In dreams, you can solve very difficult problems easily. Mathematical problem, you know, there's a difficult mathematical problem, you will spend days and days and days and you will not solve it. But in dream, it will be just all like that. Because in state of dream, we are given a facility, a swipe card for intelligence, that you can infinitely swipe. You know the card, credit card, etc., etc. You can't infinitely swipe the card. There is a limit. Is that right? Power card, infinitely you can swipe. You can be the strongest man in the world ever. You can be ever strongest ever man, person in the world, in dream. You can be intelligent, most intelligent ever person on the planet, in dreams. Because all those limitations fall apart in state of dream. You are unlimited in dream. You can be running from here to a destination 10,000 miles away, and in no time we will reach there. In no time we will reach there. The jet might take 15 hours. But you will reach in no time. So we really do not try to investigate the dreams, but a dream can have such a marvelous grant for you, endowment for you, that you will never be defeated in dreams. You will be all the time victorious. So dream has enormous powers. That is why it is worth inquiring, how is it that I can fight 10 elephants in dream? I can fight 10 elephants in dream and be victorious. How is this possible? So dream is a fabulous thing. Now why do we turn have a neglectful aspect, look at the dream? Because dreams are of several classes. Perhaps he will tell you during delineation. So there are so different classes of dreams, kinds of dreams, which you will get in that book, or you will get even in the commentary on Yoga Sutras, various kinds of dreams. Some dreams are fanciful. The dreams can take place for several reasons, which is investigated by our Shastras. Why you get dream? There are several reasons. Because there are several kinds of dreams. See, if you are afraid of someone, in dream you can have a nightmare. If you have passion for something, if you are crazy for something, if you have delirium for something, the things can appear in your dream because of delirium, because of fear, because of obsession. So there are several reasons why you get dream. All dreams are not worth considering true. Many of the dreams are after all dreams. But again, dream is not illusion. This also should be noted here. Dream is not viparyaya. That's why it's a separate vritti in Patanjali's scheme. He doesn't equate. We think dreams are illusory. More often we get illusory dreams. Is that right? After the dream, we say, oh, it was illusion. It was after all dream. Dream is not illusion. Because for illusion, the illusion is illusion when it is invalidated by perception. If you recall our description on viparyaya vritti, viparyaya is viparyaya only when it is disproved by a valid vritti. Swapna is not invalidated like that. You don't say, I saw elephant in the dream. No, it was not elephant. Like in viparyaya, illusion, you say, I I am seeing snake. And then you say, no, it was not snake, it was rope. So rope perception invalidates. Nothing of that kind happens in dream. You don't say, oh, it was not elephant. Because in illusion, there are similar objects. There is similarity between the objects. You can't say, oh, it was not snake, it was tiger. You will say, it was not snake, it was rope. Right? Is that right? Because snake and rope has some similarity. So illusions take place when there is similarity in two objects. And that's why we say, oh, this was not snake, this was rope. We don't say, this was not snake, this was Prashant. That's illusion, it doesn't happen like that. So this is Swapna Vrutti, is a different Vrutti. That's why it is come in Nidra Vrutti. So these are not illusions. Sleep, the dream might be illusory. But the dream is not illusion. Are you getting it? Dream might be illusory, but dream is not illusion. This is how philosophical inquiries take place with respect to a phenomenon, an object, or a condition, or a precept. So the dream can occur for various reasons. Suppose you are not well, indisposed, you get dreams. So Ayurvedic perspective says if you have vata pitta kapha vikaras, you have classes of dreams. Vata gives you a kind of dream, some fast dream, fast moving objects that you are running around, you are going helter skelter, you are in a kinetic kind of motion. Speedy dreams, you get speedy dreams, a fast train running, fast vehicles going, somebody running, cheetah running in dream, so speed. So vata vikara, the dreams are with reference to speed. Pitta vikara, the dreams are with reference to bright objects or fire. And kapha vikara, the dreams pertain to white color, water, ocean, snow-covered mountains, or white color dreams, white objects of dreams. So vata, pitta, kapha. So there are, now this is because of your indisposition, imbalance in your keels of the body, you get dreams. Obsessions of mind, panic, fear of mind, you get dreams. There is also dream without such reasons. The mystics have most of their revelations in dream. That's called drishtanta. Drishtanta hone. Most of wisdom comes by drishtanta, and that is a kind of dream. Most of revelations, yogis have great revelations not through samadhi as much as through drishtanta. Most of realities are realized out of that kind of dream, because you have unlimited power, prowess, intellectual, mental and consciousness powers are sky is the limit, and therefore you can perceive so many things, cognize so many things, recognize so many things, see so many things, understand and comprehend so many things. Otherwise we won't comprehend with limitations in us. So that's a kind of the dreams, allegorical dreams, prophetic dreams. So if you look into my book, you will get to know various types of dreams. Sometimes there are prophetic dreams. They tell you what is going to happen. Premonitions you get in dream. So dream is an enormous world. That's why he says refer to dream world. Dream is itself a world by itself. Don't just consider dream states or dreams. That's why we have concepts such as dream land, dream world. So we need to have inquiry into dream world. That is what is expected here. So for us to know what is Swapna Jnanam, so it's an enormous faculty in human beings that we are having the dreamability. We are able to get dreams in sleep. Dreams also give you experiences of pain and pleasure, sorrows and delights. Certain delights you will never experience in this life. You will have to take another life to experience that. You can't get certain experiences in this life. However, dream has a provision. It can give you that experience this life itself. So much has been explored about dreams, analyzed about dreams. What is impossible in this life, dreams make it possible. Is it not marvelous? You will have to wait for another life. But dreams give a facility, you don't have to wait. You can get here and now. That's how karma phala. Fruition of certain karmas take place in dream. They can't take place in awakeful state because of delimitation that you have. In dream you are neither man or woman. So woman can experience manly aspects. Men can experience womanly aspects in state of dream. This will not be possible in this life. A man will have to wait to become woman for another life, or woman similarly. Dream is wonderful probability. Anyway, don't get into dream world now.
Okay. So we saw that Svapnavastha is Kevala Vasana Matra Prajna. Now, let us look at Nidra. We have already looked at Nidra when we talked about Nidra as a Vritti. So let's look at sort of some parts of it, not the whole thing, in interest of time. So there is a very nice line in the Vivaranam about Nidra that very concisely describes what it is. It says, Nidra Jnanam Tu Visheshagrahanatmakam. So it is Vishesha means specific, a particular, Agrahanatmakam. So the grahana does not exist. So the instrument of knowing, the mechanism of knowing, or grahana means more about taking in. So that does not exist. Normally our senses are active and they are taking in something. In the Svapnavastha also something is getting illuminated and therefore there is some bhoga or something happening at that point. This is a vishesha agrahanatmakam. So that is not happening. Abhava pratyayalambanam. This is something already what's part of the sutra, where the imprint or the pratyaya, the support that the chitta takes, is that of abhava. Abhava means absence. So the support of the chitta is about the absence of things. So abhava pratyalambanam shantam anantam anubhuyamana. Okay, so this is very beautiful. So anubhuyamana means in the process of experiencing, right? It's a sort of a progressive present tense, continuous present tense. So anubhuyamana, experiencing what? Shantam anantam. So shantam is complete, one that is peaceful and one that is infinite. Shantam and anantam. So one that is completely placid, one that is infinite. In some sense, the paramatma. So shantam anantam anubhuyamana. So experiencing that. Achalana dharmakam. So what is the dharma of it? Dharma as in what is the characteristic? The characteristic is one that is devoid of movement, achalana. So there is no movement. So shantam anantam anubhuyamana chalana dharmakam. This is a single word which has such a depth of meaning, and this is the state of nidra that is to be understood. So I'll just repeat that. Nidra jnanam tu vishesha agrahanatmakam abhava pratyayalambanam shantam anantam anubhuyamana achalana dharmakam. So that is nidra. So I'll repeat a few things that we looked at when we looked at nidra as a vritti. So here, for example, Guruji said, senses of perception rest in the mind, mind in the consciousness, and consciousness in being. So that in very simple terms is capturing a lot of the things mentioned in the Vedas and the Shastras. So nidra is also said as sushupti avasthasu anyavastha medhya manaha sanyogaha. So manaha means mind, the regular mind that generally operates. Medha refers to dharanavat buddhi. So that kind of buddhi as a sort of an aspect of intellect. but not just intellect on its own, it's a dharanavat. So intellect as in the state of dharana, where it is the scope of the buddhi is confined to a certain particular thing on which the dharana dhyana is happening. So that particular kind of medha, when the mana comes in touch with it, that is nidra. Okay, that is a kind of avastha which is nidra, where there is steadiness, right? And absence of activity. So that is another way it is very nicely defined. There is another very beautiful analogy. And when Guruji says senses of perception rest in the mind, mind in consciousness, consciousness in being. So I'll just go over one analogy that says, sa yatha shakunihi sutrena prabaddo disham disham patitva. So here the analogy is, picture like a hunter who is catching birds and who is tied a bird to his arm with a string. So what does the bird do? The bird is flying hither and thither. Okay, so disham disham patitva is trying to fly away, but it's tied with a string. Anyatra ayatanam alabdhva. So it is not able to find any resting place because it's tied to a string, it's trying to fly away, unable to fly away. Bandhanam eva upashrayate. In the end, it gets tired and rests on the hand itself. So the one that has tied it, it finally, after trying to go hither and thither and so on, it rests on the hand itself. Evameva khalu somya. So similarly, so is this the Rishi explaining? So similarly, oh dear one, tan manaha, that particular manas or mind, disham disham patitva, trying to go here and there because it's of the nature of activity, uncontrollable and so on. Again, anyatra ayatanam alabdhva, not finding a place to rest, similar to that bird. Pranam eva upashrayate. Finally, it finds rest in the mukhya prana. That particular state of that happening is also known as sushupti. Okay, so that is another very picturesque description of the nidra avastha that happens. Then it says, yatra supto na kanchana kamayate na kanchana swapnam pashyati tat sushuptam. Okay, so there is no desires and there is no dream to be seen. That is sushupti. Another beautiful description is sattva pradhanam ajnanam. So this is ajnanam. So this is not a state of knowledge, because the viveka khyati or the realization of self and so on is not happening. But what is the nature of this ajnanam? It is sattva pradhanam. So it is full of the sattvika guna. And it's sort of paradoxical in the sense that the sattva stands for jnana, right? So this is sattva pradhanam ajnanam. And this is similar to what Guruji says. He says, sleep gives one a glimpse of the seer, but only indistinctly, since the viveka is clouded. And simulation of sleep when one is awake, aware and awake, is samadhi, where seer witnesses his own form. Right? So these two are very close together. And then he also mentions the sutras from Sankhya that says, samadhi sushupti mokshesu brahma rupata. So when do you get the form of the Brahman? The Brahma Rupata is in Samadhi, Sushupti, the dreamless sleep, and Moksha. So these are the three states. So these are sort of, I'm giving you the glories of Nidra and Sushupti state, because that is what you are supposed to take the support of as part of the Chitta Parikarma in the Sutra that we are seeing. Okay, another beautiful description is Tad Brihadaranyaka Upanishad Tad Yata Priyaya Striya Samparishvakto na bhayam kinchana vedanantaram. So here it says, once when somebody is embracing his beloved, the dear beloved, then he is not aware of anything external, not aware of anything internal. Na bhaya kinchana vedanantaram. Evameva ayam purushaha. In this state, this purusha, in the state of nidra, prajnyenatmana. So with the essential awareness, with the Paramatma, Samparishvakto. So the Purusha, the Jivatma, the Purusha, the individual soul is embracing the Paramatma, okay, the universal soul, the Lord, and so on. Na bhayam kinchana vedanantaram. Similarly, not aware of anything outside, not aware of anything inside. So this is where the aspect of bliss is also coming in, beautifully, where it is mentioned. Tadva asya etat. So in this state, apta kamam, so all the desires are fulfilled. So apta kamam, atma kamam. So all the desires are within oneself, right? And so there is nothing outside that is required. Akamam, no desires, right? So all of these, it's a unison of all these states. Rupam, shokantaram, it is completely outside of, devoid of any sorrow. So that is what is being said. And like he is saying, you are neither a man nor a woman and so on. It says, atra pita apita bhavati. So father is not a father. Mata amata. Loka alokaha. Devaha adevaha. Vedaha avedaha. So there is no particular delimitation. There is no particular characteristic. Everything goes away. Because this is the essential state of being and the unity with the Paramatma in that state. However, because of that sattva pradhanam ajnanam, which is also known as buddhisattvachhadakam tamaha. So all of this is happening, but it is sort of covered by a certain curtain. So the awareness doesn't exist at that point in time. So that particular state is sushupti or nidra. And now that one has this nidra jnanam, making the support of this is what is being the second part of the sutra we are considering, swapna nidra jnana lambanam va. So that is how this sutra 1.38 is to be understood here.
So about the nidra jnana lambanam, nidra, we just take it as sleep, and because of this preconceived notion, and then at the most what? It's a rest for brain, we say. It is rest for body, rest for mind, rest for brain. So these are very mean approaches to understand the marvelous state of sleep. Because sleep, as I said, you will never get to know what is sleep by sleeping every day. Although we sleep every day, we will never have knowledge about it. So understand the mysterious aspect behind that. Rather, usually when we experience something very, 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 very often, we tend to get some knowledge base. We say, now I know it. I've experienced umpteen number of times. I have experienced hundreds of times, thousands of times, millions of times. I know something about it. But look at this marvel. Dream, the sleep. You might experience every day. Some of them experience even twice a day or thrice a day, starting from dope, state of dope and etc., etc. But yet we do not have any knowledge about it. That's really very a mysterious world. Like as I said, the world of dreams, the world of dormancy is also a mysterious world. If you want to know anything about it, it's only through the agamas you will come to know, and the agamas explain it. As to what is this state? See, if you feel that you just get refreshed by state of sleep, then you have so many other refreshing agencies, but you don't get as refreshed as you get in state of sleep. It is something much more than just being refreshed. It is something much more than just being rested. Because even after a rest, you have some positive outcomes that you experience. So it is not just rest. So as he said that the bird, Shakuni, which rests on the hand, this gets into main prana. Now that's a great world within ourselves. Like taking dip in Gangotri, for Indians, you know, that's Ganga is very pure water, very pure river. So having a dip in Ganga has different significance than taking dip in any other river. So this is where the Chaturdasha Karana, the 14th organs of the embodiment, rest in prana. They take respite in prana. They get absorbed in prana. That's a marvelous state. Because none of us really know what is prana. But then we all have taken dip into prana during every sleep, dreamless sleep. So something much more happens. So you can take a shower in your bath, a shower bath in your bathroom. You can take a dip in any river and take a dip in Ganga. There is big difference in taking a dip in Ganga. So this is, a sleep is such an enormous dip in the lake of consciousness. In the lake of consciousness, which divine as you. Not only that, your finite soul, which is longing to meet the beloved, can only get that dating in sleep. Not otherwise. So imagine the beloved and lover being separated. What is the condition if it is separated for a couple of hours, couple of days, etc.? You know what's the sorrow. So the finite soul gets to meet its beloved, the infinite. So it's a great kind of encounter, which ends in embrace. Just meeting is one thing, and embracing is another thing. Between a lover and beloved. So the finite soul goes into the bosom of the divinity. So imagine what must be the degree of bliss. If you want to know the calculus of bliss, look into Taittiriya Upanishad, which mentions you the table. It gives you a table of bliss. And infinite bliss is called Brahmananda. The finite bliss is called Manavananda, mortal, bliss of a mortal to the bliss of the immortal. So every night when we have sleep for whatever length of duration of time, we have touchstone effect of that infinitude of bliss. And this is the great bonanza. We really don't pay value to it. Only we don't get it, we understand the value of it. If we don't sleep, then you know the problem of not sleeping. But we don't recognize the bonanza of sleep. It's a great bonanza. Again, it's a mysterious world of state of sleep. It's a marvelous scheme of the nature to give every biological creature a state of sleep. It's a great bounty. Non-living things do not require sleep, but all living beings require sleep, and that's a great bounty, great bonanza. We must have gratitude for what these endowments are there for us from nature. We tend to take for granted, and we never give due recognition to it, gratitudes for it, what the nature has given to us. We only keep on blaming what we don't have, which we expect from nature. But what the nature has given, we don't bother about it. Therefore, it's a great pursuit to have Nidra Jnanam. So it will tell you what this marvel is. Sapna Jnanam, what marvel this is. A wonderful archetypal scheme for us to be given these states of consciousness, awakeful, dormant, dreamy, and then transcendent. So that's why some jnana about that is so important, paramount in adhyatmic pursuit. So that's why that is deemed that you have that knowledge. That is why there is no delineation. Student of Adhyatma is supposed to understand certain basic tenets of Adhyatma, such as our state of being, four states of consciousness. So there are Upanishads which have dedicated to that. They have explained that from different perspectives. Adi Bhautik, Adi Daivik, Adhyatmik, Metaphysical, Metapsychological. So many perspectives are there. So it's a marvel to have a pursuit as to what is Nidra Gnan, what is Swapna Gnan. So also, what is Jagrata Gnan. We all have this state. We have no idea of what this state is.
Okay, so we'll stop here. Next time we'll look at the next sutra, which will tell us about the last of the alternatives for Chitta Parikarma. So let's recite the shlokas on Guruji, then take one or two questions.
Vaijnanika Shikshakatve
Kalakara Asaneshu Yaha
Yoga Abhyase Cha Tattvajnyas
Tam Vande Sundaram Gurum
Yoga Vrukshol Lokesmin
Vardhito Yasya Preranaya
Yoga Acharyaya Gurave
Sundaraya Namo Namaha
So any questions?
Sir, you mentioned about Swapna as a vritti and the vritti nirodha that we try to do. In case of Swapna, how do we do that?
See, for you, Swapna Vritti is only Swapna that you get in when you are in sleep. You can't be having a dream at all, not having slept. So you are only considering that aspect of Swapna, which, if you recall the Sutra of Nidra, which was discussed by us, Patanjali doesn't mention Swapna Vritti there. Pramana Viparya Vikalpa Nidras Putayaha. Where is dream? So you are referring to this dream that you get in sleep, but it's a wider concept. But here the Swapna Jnanam pertains to only that Jnanam. Now where is the question of restraining it when it is going to give you Chitta Prasadanam? Why do you want to restrain it? Where is the question of restraining it? Because this is Nidra Jnanam is something that gives you not only Aklishta Vritti, but gives you some, Parishkruta Chitta, Chitta Parikarma. It is coming in Chitta Parikarma. So therefore, these Vrittis, nowhere restraint has been described. Vishokava Jyotishpati. Why do you want to restrain it? Vishayavati Pravritya. Do you want to restrain it? Vitaraga Vishayam Vachittam, do you want to restrain it? So there is no question of restraint here in entire topic of Chitta Parikarma, right from Maitri Kurana Murita Upeksha to the Yathamipada Dhyana Dva. So there is no question of restraining it. Now if you want to restrain the Nidra, the Swapna Vritti, suppose all the time you are getting disturbing dreams, and then naturally you'll have to take some measures. But suppose you are getting wonderful dream, do you want to restrain it? If you are getting wonderful dreams every time, do you want that to be... Many times you don't want the dream to be broken. Somebody wakes you from your dream, you get wild because you are in wonderful dream. Yes, if the dreams are troublesome, naturally there are certain measures to be taken which Dharma Shastra tells you. Every night, suppose you are getting a dream of a cobra and you are getting petrified. Now, you don't want this to be continuing. You want this dream to be restrained at some stage. Is that right? So, there are certain measures mentioned in Dharma Shastra as to what you should be doing every time you are getting a petrified dream, every time you are getting a dream, the untoward dream, and it disturbing you, creating a problem to you, then there are measures to take. So for common man, there are certain measures. So they will be told certain things, do this, and then sometimes simple thing like go and just offer Bilva Patra to Shiva, is Shiva in temple, so that you will not get these nightmarish dreams. So many other things are there like that. And if you are getting dream because of, say, obsession, you know that during the daytime the obsession doesn't bother you. But if that comes in dream, it bothers you. Every day that is coming to your dream, it bothers you. You don't get good sleep at all. If you have obsession for something and then every day you are getting that in your dream, you get disturbed sleep and you want to restrain it. So of course, then you have to take certain measures. Yoga has so many measures, satsanga, sadhana sangha, shastra sangha. So enormous quiver is available for these measures wherever swapna is to be restrained. However, swapna jnana is not a matter to be restrained. Swapna might be a matter to be restrained, not swapna jnana. As to why the dreams are there, why the dream world is there, why it is part of your consciousness, this need not be restrained. Okay?
Yeah, I mean, just one clarification. So when it says yoga chitta vritti nirodha, it is not an active imperative that is being suggested there. Okay? So there are many various means given to purify the chitta. Then there is tapasvadhyaya, ishvara pranidhana, then there is ashtangas and so on. All those are sadhanani. So what yoga chittavritti nirodha says, at the state where the chittavritti nirodha happens, that is known as yoga. Okay, so it is not an active imperative, it is to recognize that particular thing as what is to be labeled as yoga. That is the nature of the definition given there. So there is nowhere where any vritti, it is saying actively go and restrain it. There is abhyasa, there is vairagya, those are all means. But nowhere is there a strict active restraining thing suggested in the entire text.
Otherwise, best way to restrain vrittis is become unconscious. Take some comatose drugs, go to a physician and have a drip of comatic drug and then go to become unconscious.
Okay, one last question, if any.
I just want to share that you said in dreams there are revelations. Not only in spiritual pursuit, I remembered one from my science books. Kekule dreamt about benzene rings. So he used that dream for really coming out benzene formula.
Yeah, so these kind of, methods are there for, like, Feynman says that, Poincaré says that, Ramanujan says that. And in some cases, they actively used the dream state. So to actually do that. Yes. Good point.
So wish you all fruitful dreams hereafter.
So thank you.